because his whole worldview is now called into question. And in his illness, he thinks through everything that he knows as a good scientist, and he comes to the conclusion, to the conviction, that there are repeated Earth lives. And he shares that with Capasius, and Capasius is jealous. He says, oh my God, you just thought that out all by yourself, and I've been struggling with this concept, but Strotter has that kind of uncompromising thinking that is needed. But it doesn't make him happy. Casey says, oh, if it only had happened to me. But it doesn't make Strotter happy. It devastates him because he says, I'm so lonely, I must have caused it myself. I must be the cause of my own destiny. And that's horrible to him. He has to take responsibility for something that has made him miserable. And so he goes into a depression. And out of that, the way that he sees to get out of his depression is to become a workaholic. And he describes, he says, I yielded to the darkness. And he describes the life that he's leading, which is that he gets up in the morning, he goes to a factory, he's become the manager of a factory that makes screws. And he organizes, he's like the foreman of the whole factory, and keeps it going. He's there from morning till night. He comes home. He doesn't think about anything anymore. He just goes to bed and gets up in the morning and goes to work. And it's in that period of time that he meets Theodora again. And this time they find one another as souls, and they marry. And they have 7 beautiful years of marriage. And during that time, he invents a new technology that should revolutionize human work. And it doesn't work. But in principle, he's got something. But it doesn't quite work. And Theodora dies, and he becomes a pupil of Benedict. So it's it's after that that we meet him in this drama. So now Hillary's plan is based on Strotter's ability to organize things and on this hopeful invention that doesn't yet work. And we met the opposition of the office manager, and then Strotter says this amazing sentence, which is repeated 6 times in the drama. And yet will come about what has to come about. Strotter has a goal, which is to unite the spirit to earthly labor. And as I said, to radiate that back, that warmth of light back into the spiritual world. But we saw Lucifer succeeded in waylaying Capasius, who doesn't want to spoil the spirit vision with outer deeds. And this is deeply disturbing to Strotter, who admires Capasius. He thinks Capasius is more developed than him. And when he sees Capasius just capitulate, he's devastated. And Felix as well. And that is such a blow to him that he asks his important question. Remember, he actually comes forward and he says, am I the son of error, not your son, you wisdom-filled and wide-flung spirit realms? He asks, am I making a mistake? Am I wrong in wanting this as my spiritual goal, because my friends don't seem to value it anymore? It's devastating, but he dares to ask, am I wrong? And as an Benedictus tells him, don't complain that Capasius and Felix have separated and left you alone. Even though it feels awful, don't complain. Rather, gaze into your own abyss. People know that nowadays. That's a very common, I think, psychological wisdom that people have discovered. Look to yourself. You can't make something else change for somebody else, but you take care of your own problems. So gaze into your own abyss. And he dares to look there, and he sees Maria. And Maria tells him that his thirst for creating is dominating his being and preventing clear vision. She says, you're spreading darkness all around you. And that it's actually, and in the book Theosophy, Rudolf Steiner describes in the sixth region of the soul world after death, we all have to purify that part of our being which just wants to do something. And so it then takes various forms. It's artistic creation, scientific invention, whatever, animal nutrition, whatever it is, if it's actually motivated by this thirst for creativity, it isn't life bringing. It does for a time, but at a certain stage of development, you have to face it. But that's what's motivating you, and you have to purify the soul from that, just the urge, and get more to the reality of what it is that you're looking at. And then, so she tells him that, and it's quite harsh. And Benedictus shows him that Capasius and Felix are each beset by shadow beings that would deceive them. And each one, unconsciously, is forging a unique sword. And that Strotter needs to know how they are forging their sword. He has to observe that, because his sword, which is also unique, very different from theirs, will depend upon his understanding theirs. I think this has to do with what I said before about each one of us having a unique balance between Lucifer and Ahriman. That means we have a unique set of beings which try to derail us or obfuscate the truth for us, and we each have a unique sword to forge. In scene 4, we see, or we saw, how Strotter accepts the counsel of Benedictus and Maria. So they're hard on him, but he recognizes the wisdom even though he doesn't comprehend it yet. And this is something that David Schwartz taught me years and years ago, that when you have a special experience, be it a dream or a vision, it's just a beginning. It's just the beginning. You can dedicate years of your life to understanding an experience which you've had. It keeps working. So Strotter knows that. He says, I don't fully comprehend it yet, but I feel in myself the power that the teacher gave to me. And he then is still, despite the loss of Capasius, he's ready to keep going with the project. And then Benedictus breaks it to him that Johannes is also pulled out. And because of that, Maria is pulling out, because she has to go where Johannes goes. She's responsible for him. And so Benedictus is pulling back to, and there is no up, it's off. And then he says again, that will come which is to come about. And how it's actually not time for them to be effective on earth. And that it would cause harm, do evil, if they were to be active now. So the project actually, it really had to be canceled. It wasn't time for him. And so this throws him back into loneliness. And Strader says, this loneliness in truth will forge the sword. So, painful, miserable, failure, that's what he needs in order to forge his sword. Now I'm going to skip ahead to scenes we haven't seen, to the scenes that we'll see tonight, because that's what we need to meet Aramund. In scene 11, there's a conversation between Benedictus and Strader, in which we get a further explanation of the words that Benedictus had said to him before. He says again, all that will come that has to come about. But now he says, these words are not a guide. We can't use them as a guide, which would be like fatalism, but as a creative source of strength. These occult words indeed have value. There's a confidence, a creative source of strength that comes from knowing that what has to come about will come about. And then Strader shares an inner picture that he had, in which he was given the task to steer the ship that's bringing Maria and Johannes to the place where they can do their earthly work. And that there's another ship that cuts across, and it's got the business manager, the office manager, and Ahriman blocking the way, the course. And Benedictus says, so he's had a spiritual vision, but Benedictus says, it's not quite right yet. It has to mature. This vision it will mature, it can mature, but you need to strive for the strength that it will take to mature your own vision. And he said, that is for yourself and for your friends. And then we have scene 12, where we'll see Ahriman in the interior of the earth, sharing with us that Strader, who he has previously inspired to deny the spirit in nature, is getting too close to Benedictus. And he's been taught about Ahriman. So he's in the circle of learning about spiritual science. Now he knows about Ahriman. And Ahriman says, it's Strader that I need. As long as he can still have perfect faith within himself, will Benedictus easily succeed. So what does it mean to have perfect faith within ourselves? At least that's the question I have. And Ahriman then inspires the soul of Ferdinand Fox unconsciously and says, your task shall be to undermine the trust that Strader up to now has in himself. No longer then will he desire to hold to Benedictus. He wants to undermine Strader's confidence in his own self. And he knows that in doing that, Strader will then sever himself from his own teacher. That's what Ahriman wants to do. Ahriman has already read in the Book of Destiny that Strotter is going to die soon. And he knows that Benedictus can't read that. But then, before the scene is over, Theodora appears. She goes right into the interior of the earth. And she says to Ahriman that she vows to stay at Strotter's side in the spirit land or in the earthly realm. She will be faithful to Strotter, no matter where he is. And Ahriman says, if she indeed will not forsake him now, as long as he is dwelling still on earth, the battle will be lost for me. But there is hope that he can finally forget her. Well, we know he's not going to forget her. We know something that Ahriman doesn't know. And that is that love is stronger than death. Ahriman doesn't get it. But as soon as he says those words, it's like, oh, it's okay. He won't forget her, and she's already clearly not forgotten him and will stay by his side wherever he is. I don't know, does it do? For me, it's very powerful. So, nevertheless, Ferdinand Fox does his job. He comes back to Earth and he does show Strotter that there was an error in his own thinking that caused the fact that the thing didn't work. That it wasn't just that it was outer circumstances, he actually made a mistake. And Ferdinand Fox is smart enough to point it out to him. And with Ahriman's inspiration, he does it. And so in scene 13, we have a conversation between Hilary and Romanus in which we hear that Strotter's burdened and torn by bitter agonies of doubt. So, fingers. But Romanus, well, I'm so glad for your characterization of Romanus. I love Romanus. He says such wonderful things. He senses the presence of the guardian at Strotter's side. And Romanus says, with courage, he will come to the conviction that self-enlightenment must come through pain. The will becomes companion to the one who bravely goes to meet what is to come. And fortified by hope's life-giving stream, will boldly face the pain which knowledge brings. So Romanus sees spiritually that Strotter will face the pain of the knowledge of his own false process. And then Hilary and Romanus go off, and Hippasius and Felix come in, and they are looking for Benedictus in Hilary's house, and if they can't find Benedictus, they'll talk to Hilary. They want to share that Hippasius has had a vision this morning. It's like fresh. And they've come to tell that he's had a vision in which Strotter has spoken to him. And Strotter has inspired Hippasius to metamorphose, to transform the words that Felix had said before about the mystic mood. And he actually makes them right. So, he says, he confirms that the mystic's solemn mood is necessary the revelation. You can't. So he confirms the mystic solemn mood. He says it will awake in the stream of life when the soul has strengthened itself through thoughtful searching. Felix said, forget the striving. We just heard how striving is very important. This mood, Strotter says, can come in quiet hours, so you're meditating, or in the heat of action, but wants us to maintain our thinking in our vision. So, Strotter helps Capasius to find a right relation to Felix, who he has kind of unhelpfully glommed onto as his role model. You saw that. Okay. That will help. That will help Capasius to find a guardian. Then, in scene 14, we find out that Strotter has died. And then in the last scene, scene 15, Benedictus receives a letter from Strotter that he had written just before his death, the nursing gift. And he starts to read it, and he actually reads out loud, so we get to hear Strotter's words. My friend, when I felt close to being my fellow teacher, I died. I did what I needed to do. I saw the picture correctly, and now we can pass on. And the final encounter with Ahriman is not Strotter anymore, it's Benedictus. And I'm interested to hear how Daniel interprets it. I've heard many people say, oh, how terrible, Benedictus didn't recognize Ahriman. And he doesn't at first. But I'm thrilled by this last scene. For some reason, it doesn't seem to me as a failure. I'm watching how Benedictus does it, goes about recognizing